Every time I look at a Facebook quote, it's exactly what I need to hear. I don't know how this is possible, actually. Just maybe you're experiencing the same thing, right? I said, you gotta be kidding me. That's exactly what I needed to hear. And maybe you're experiencing also that when you do this wow practice, the breakthrough is so great, you really can't explain it very well unless someone else has had the same breakthrough, right? And then they say, oh yeah, but yeah, that's about it. I mean, so do the wow practice and find out what happens. So we will just do a quick, you know, run through of the wow practice, and take it like this, that the wow is like the sun in the sky. As it rises up in the sky, all the stars disappear, and the stars are all other thoughts. Just the wow thought is the royal, ultimate thought that is so grand, it's literally like as bright as the sun in the sky. All other thoughts absolutely pale and disappear in comparison to the wow thought. So have this feeling and conviction and belief, and I believe it. You know, this is how I really approach it, with real strong feeling and conviction, and I'm all in on this. So to try and give attention to any other thought is like, feels just completely wrong. So let the wow thought just be this tremendous majesty in your mind, and you're just so compelled to just pay attention to it, and none other. Like you're so in love, you can't even imagine looking anywhere else, right? It's just, it's so compelling. It's so compelling. And there's a spider here repelling from the light standard. There's always a spider somewhere, isn't there? That's why I had to get over my fear of spiders. Because I said, it's not going to be a happy life if I go through life being scared of spiders. And it's not going to be a happy life going through life trying to pay attention to all these thoughts. You know, which star do I look at now? This constellation, that constellation, what does it all mean? The movements of the constellations, astrology, astronomy. Instead, just pay attention to the wow thought. And all of that stuff about influences and dynamics, all of that disappears. It all disappears. And you just say, I'm only being influenced by the wow thought. I'm only being influenced by the wow thought. That's it. Nothing else is influencing me. And I just have this 360-degree wow-ness. That's my only thought. That's the sun in my inner sky. And then see what happens. See what you're experiencing as light. And then be quiet about it. Maybe there's nothing you can say about it, actually. So, I'm far into that territory already, where it's better to leave it unsaid, really. I mean, leaving it unsaid is a clearer explanation than trying to say something. If that makes any sense at all. And maybe it does, right? Maybe you're already there. Maybe you're even farther along than I am in that territory. So you say, oh yeah, that's absolutely right. Saying nothing at all says it better than saying anything. And that's really a way to look at it, actually. It's like anything you can say is totally redundant. Totally redundant. So does engaging in redundancy, does that really reflect properly? Or just being silent really reflect more properly the absolute redundancy of everything? How can you even express such a situation? It simply baffles all expectations, actually. It completely baffles all expectations. So why even engage in expectations? Why even play that game? It's better to just give this vibe of, hey, we're journeying beyond expectations. Any expectations, actually. But you have to be patient. Very patient. I'm being very patient these days. Just trusting it, having faith. I know I'm in the deep end. So just hang out in the deep end. Ah, I had a dream last night. Just remembered it. How extraordinary this dream was. I was in this church, and it was all dark, dim. In fact, I was in a church a couple days ago just like this. And it's all kind of, you know, churchy, a little oppressive, so churchy. You're looking around, it's dark, and wondering, wow. And then you look through this glass window and into this room, and there was all these vials with different amounts of black liquid in them, or like dark blood or something. It was like, it was horrible. I said, oh my God, I'm trapped in here. I'm trapped in this place, worshiping blood. Obsessed with blood. It was horrible. And in my mind, I was thinking, how do I get out of this place? Because I was in this church a couple days ago, and I actually had this camera, and I wanted to take this picture of a stained glass window, and it turned on the camera, and I went, ding. I said, ah. And I did the shutter, went, ch-ch-ch. I said, ah. Because it was so quiet in there. And so I tried to take one more picture, tried to get away with it, but someone in the church turned around and looked at me like, gave me the devil stare, you know. And I tried to go out the door. I said, oh, let me get out of here. They're going to chase me. And the door was like being stuck. I said, oh my gosh, how do I get out of here? I'm trapped. Angry people say, don't make any sound in our church. So a semi barged through the door and got out of there. It was a kind of scary experience, actually. So here I'm having this dream, kind of a nightmare. And suddenly, this beautiful arch door, something, it opened. It was like a vault-like door, right? Heavy vault-like door. Like we were trapped in this vault. It started to swing open. And I took my attention off all this vials of glasses, wine glasses of blood or whatever they had there. And I saw this light coming. The door was opening. I saw this light coming in the door. There's this fresh, beautiful light. And I said, oh my God. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. And it led to this beautiful garden. I could see a little bit of the garden, the beautiful light coming in. And I said, oh my God, I can get out of this church. I can get out of this place. Okay, so this is the dream set up. Now, my meditation, my clarification on what did I do? What did I do? What would you do? And I'm thinking, okay, maybe I should go open that door all the way. I need to open the door all the way and rush out into the garden and everything. But I said, you know, wait a minute. How am I feeling right now? And I'm feeling like, wow, very intense, wow. So I said, okay, now wait a minute, full stop in the wow. Okay, full stop in the wow here. And I said to myself in this sort of dream imagery, I said, you know, just leave the door open just a little, it's the crack, just a little bit. Just leave it like that, enough to see the light. And I said, okay, now, I'm not going to go running out that door. I'm not going to try to fling the door wide open and dash out into the light, okay? That's not the wise move. The wise move is to turn and look at the church, this place that, you know, this place that really I felt so creeped out. I don't want to stay here. And feel, what is my attitude now towards this church that now I see the light streaming into this place? And I know the light is there, and I can see it, and it's actually it's coming into the church, right? Through the door, barely open, but it's coming in. How do I feel now about this church? What's my attitude? How has my attitude changed? So just sit quietly and just realize that there's a changed attitude. There's a changed attitude. And get used to that changed attitude first. Okay, so we're capping our expectations here. We're not going to rush into the light. We're going to stay in the church. And we're just going to experience the church now with the light, the true light shining into it. You know, the unaltered light, the clear light that is shining into it. And the freshness and the freedom that you're feeling coming into that church now. We're just going to stay in that church and say, how do I feel? What's my attitude now? And just be quiet with that. This is part of the essence of our practice. It's a slightly different emphasis, isn't it? One is just hold up one thought in your mind, wow, and this one is to cap your expectations and look for an attitude shift first based on the insight, so to speak, the clarity that is coming into you. How does that change your attitude towards everything? It requires a lot of discipline, a lot of patience, courage, fortitude, wisdom. So when we have these inner experiences, Jesus remarks in A Course in Miracles, he says, it's most likely that you will not be shifting your location. In the great majority of cases, he says, you'll probably stay just where you are. And because the first thing that has to happen is an attitude change. So we're really aiming for an attitude change where you are right now. Okay. We're not trying to shift you in some different place so you'll have a different attitude. We want your attitude change to happen right where you are. He says, by far and away, that's what really happens for most of us. Certainly, for me, that's what's happened. I haven't gone anywhere in basically almost 40 years of A Course in Miracles. I've just been in the exact same spot. Haven't gone anywhere. 40 years. Because I'm still working on that attitude change. Still working on that attitude change. Now it's coming. It's coming. I mean, it's here, actually. I don't know how my attitude is going to change exactly. But it's changing. It is changing. And so it's kind of a stressful time. Because so much has happened, so much light has come in, that I know it's bound to have some effect on my attitude. So I'm just kind of waiting to see how that plays out. And then Jesus said, and then when your attitude changes, maybe you might be moved somewhere if you're going to be more effective there or something. He said, that's possible. And that's what I'm looking at, actually, as indication that something is coming up for me. There really is. But I don't really focus on that. I don't rush towards that light. I say, how has my attitude changed to everything around me here? I try to keep my mind just open. I don't have any idea of what it's going to be like, although it tends to be surfacing more and more and more. I have these more and more breakthroughs, and then I kind of forget what the breakthrough was because I'm in the shock of it. It's so inexpressible, nothing you can really say about it without just, again, baffling expectations, actually. And no one wants to have their expectations baffled. Right? It's torment, right? So, one has to be very, very skilled in this practice to not struggle with expectations. To just let them be baffled and just be patient. And say, okay, I have faith that this is just going to be exactly, you know, what I want it to be, beyond all expectations. Inexpressible, really, inexpressibly wonderful. And I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. So it's stressful. And so it takes this discipline and patience to minimize the stress. To stay right where I'm at is very difficult. But I'm just sitting still, not saying much, being quiet, being patient. As Rumi says, love will answer. Love will answer. We cannot resist our patience like this. So when those breakthroughs come, you sit quietly, be patient, accept the shock of it, and then consider, how is this going to change? How has this changed my perspective, my attitude of everything? Let it be inexplicably so. Inexplicably so. So it's a great time. It's a great time. Because it won't always be like this. Because at some point, the attitude is going to be full blown, right? And that's a whole different story. So I'm enjoying this sort of transitional time. Because it won't last. It won't last. It won't last forever. So enjoy, smell the roses. Stop and smell the roses, even when you're in transition. Don't be in a hurry when you're in transition. It's a precious time. Because it's quite unique experience. Something to savor, actually. And then, who knows? Yeah, who knows? All right. I got this done. It's late. But better late than never. Wow.